Hey there YouTube, my name is Julian Pösnika for Not a Picture, and today we're having a look at the creation of this simulation. We're using Blender 4.1 Alpha. The first steps are the base positions on which each of the rose petals lay. Let's assume the base would be a spiral. To create a spiral, add a meshline tool and increase its count, which will determine the number of petals. Then change its position by separating the position axes and multiplying the z value by a custom number. This value will later be the radius of the spiral. Then we multiply the z values again by a math node set to 2 radians with a degree of 137.5. Then we add a cosine math node and multiply its value by the first multiplication. The result will determine the x positions. Then we repeat the aforementioned steps and use the sine math node, which will then be multiplied with the first multiplication again. This result determines the y values. If we change the radius, we can see the spiral. And I think adding a mesh to points node makes it clearer. Now we can add petals on each of these points. Our goal is to control each petal individually in rotation, scale and simulation. So we add an instance on points node, then we'll group only that node and we change the group's inputs to geometry, index and subdivision level. Now our plan is to spawn only one petal by the instance on points node based on the index. So each group will only control one petal. We can change the scaling and simulation based on the individual group inputs. That means that every change in the group will change the base for every petal, but the simulation or animation status is different. To control the subdivision level, we add the node's subdiv level input to the GeoNode's group inputs. The index input value must be increased by 1 every time. Then we duplicated the group 40 times. The duplicated groups will be joined by the join geometry node. Thereafter, we limit the instance on point selection by adding a comparison node which will compare the index and the input index value. This will ensure that each node group will only have one spawned petal. Then we add a grid as the base for the petals, which will be connected to the instance on points node's instance input. If everything is set up correctly, the grid should be scattered 40 times in a spiral form. Now let's decrease its size and increase the vertices. And let's decrease the spiral radius. Now we can manipulate the grid to form a petal. Therefore, we group the grid and add the group inputs, stage, index and subdivision level. Then we add the index and subdiv level value of the parent node. The stage input is loose for now. In the petal group, we transform the grid. Then we add a set position node to form the basic roundish shape. For that, we add a position node and connect the x values to the y values. Then we add a RGB curve to define the shape. In the map range node, we change the input values so the RGB curve parameter matches the length of the shape. After the rough shape is defined, we add a subdivision surface node to scale the quality of the mesh. Then we add the group subdiv level input to the subdivision's node level input. Now we can change the subdivision value in the modifier stack. This will come in handy later. The next step is about bending the shape. To accomplish that, we add a position node and connect the x values to the z values. With a vector math scale node, we can change the strength of this effect. With a color ramp, we smooth out the steepness. The mode ease will give us the smoothest result in this case. Next, we distort the form based on a noise texture. We add a set position node and add the position to a vector math node and connect the second input to a combine XYZ node. The X value is then connected to the group index value. This vector will be the vector input of a Voronoi texture. So each petal will get a different noise value and therefore will get a unique form. We set the texture mode to smooth F1 and change the scale. Then we connect the texture color output to a combine XYZ node and we connect the resulting vector to the offset. Then we add a color ramp to change the effectiveness of the distortion. If we increase the subdivision level, the effect gets clearer. Now we can store the UV map because the basic shape is set. Therefore, we add a store named attribute node, set it to vector, and add a UV unwrap node. Then we add a math node and an edge angle node to specify the seam of the UV wrapping. And don't forget to give the attribute a name. Now we recenter the petals. Then we distort the form further by adding another noise texture, and this texture's X scale is decreased to get a stretched version of it. Now the values are connected to the Z position, and the strength is changed by a color ramp node. Then the index is used as the time input, so that each petal has a different version of the noise. To emphasize the difference, the index will be multiplied a little bit. And now the fun part. In the next steps, we let the petals wiggle in the wind. We use the Voronoi texture as the base and set it to 4D and change the scale and detail values. Then we subtract each axis by 0.5 and scale the effect down. For the animation, we add a scene time node, which gets connected to the W input of the Voronoi texture. The scene time node output value will be then divided by a high number, so the animation speed is slower and therefore more realistic. If we play the animation, we see the wiggle effect. The next part changes the bending based on the index and on the stage factor. Here we add a position node again, separate its channels and add a map range node, connect the X output to it and connect the map range to the Z value. So, as before, the Z value rises along the X axis. Then we add a math node to the max output value of the map range node. We set it to multiply and we add the index value and the stage value. If this works, we can see the effect happening by changing the stage value. Then we change the index input value with the math power calculation, and later we change the input through the map range node. We repeat this on the stage value, so we add a map range node and a float curve node. We change the values so the bending direction can go both ways and is smooth. In the next setup, we define the concave curvature. After we added a set position node, we add a position node that gets separated and then the Y channel goes into the map range node. In this case, the value is unlike the X value, positive and negative. So we set a value as the maximum input and the same value but multiplied by -1 as the minimum. Then we add another map range node and a color ramp node. We connect them and connect the mentioned minimum and maximum values to the output values of the second node. So, in this case, the range doesn't change in total, but the color ramp node gets values from 0 to 1. The result gets connected to the Z value offset. And now, if we change the color ramp values, the form should move as intended. Then we multiply the result with the index value to get a different curvature. We change its input values and we do the same with the stage values, so it is controllable. Here we change the mapping again. In the next part, we'll randomize the form even further by adding a map range node which gets the index as an input. Then a position node gets separated into its axis and then combined to the position input of the set position node. On the X position, we add a math multiply node, which is connected to a random value node. We add the index values as an ID and as a seed and change the min and max values. We repeat this for the Y and Z positions and change the min and max values to different numbers. Next, we set the scale. For that, we add a position node, two vector math scale nodes and a math node, which is set to power. The stage group input goes into the base input of the math node. The exponent value gets animated later to get more control. The next step is about setting up the scale along the index value to get tiny petals on the inside and bigger ones on the outside. So here we add a position node again and we add a vector math scale node. Then we connect the index group input to the vector math scale input. So for now the petals get bigger if the index gets higher. To reduce the effect, we add a map range, change its values, and we add a math power node to further control the way the scales increases. And then we add a RGB curve node to manually randomize the scale. And then we add a second subdivision surface modifier to raise the poly count. And at last we rotate the petals in this direction. Our next goal is to turn the petals in the right direction and arrange them so that they form a rose. And this happens in the petals' parent group. First, we add an align Euler to vector node, then we set it to y and change the z value to -1. After that, we duplicate this node and add a position and a vector math node to the vector input. We set the vector math node to multiply and set the z value to 0. Then we connect the index group value into the first align Euler to vector node's factor input. In the next steps, we change the index values so they clip at certain values and animate in a pleasing way. First, we add a map range to swap the index value. The next map range node changes the range of the input and output so that most of the input values are used. The next map range nodes change the input and output ranges so the animation has a nice automatic roll off. Especially in this node, the smooth step setting is important. But these values will be very dependent on your setup, and they will be, in your project, totally different than ours. So in this case, it is more like trying out what fits. Okay, and this value will be important because we'll animate it later with keyframes. Oh, and we forgot to uncheck the clamping here, and let's decrease the radius a little bit so the petals are not that spread out. Okay, so now we add the connection to the petal group so its stage value gets animated. So let's add a multiply math node to multiply the animated value with the index values. Set the map range node to smoother step to get a smooth animation. Now we have to go back to the rotation map range nodes and change a few values. And now we get the desired look and form. And let's animate this power math node in the petal group, which was mentioned before. And we can change the rotation values in the map range nodes as well. After we are satisfied with the animation, let's add a material, set the shading to smooth and realize the instance. Then we need the UV data outside the node setup, so we search for the stored attribute node and input the exact same name into the named attribute node. And then we'll connect the vector data to the group output. Then we give the attribute a name and we can use this data in the shader editor later. Speaking of the shader editor, let's open it and add an attribute node. So first, we check the name of the UV attribute and copy it to the node. Let's go into the render view so we can see the material. If everything goes well, the UV map should look like this. So in the following steps, we change the UV map into lines, which we can use as a base for the texture and normal map. Let's add a vector scale node and a multiply node. Then we add a combine node with an attached x value, which will later determine the frequency of the lines. Then we duplicate the multiply node and add a fraction and a seal node. Then we connect the seal node to a white noise texture and separate its axes. Then we add a map range node for further control and connect the result to a combine node's y value. The x and z values have to be set to 1. With the vector rotate node, we rotate the lines by 90 degrees. Then we add a color ramp and use it to condense the values. And we use the second color ramp to specify the colors. Then we increase the roughness and change the index of reflection and add a little bit of subsurface scattering. For the subsurface scattering, we need a thickness, so we have to add a solidify modifier after the geonode setup, so each petal has a thickness. Then we add additional color changes to it, like this gradient texture-based secondary color. After that, we changed the subsurface color to reddish value and changed its scale. And at last, we add a bump node to specify the normal to add more detail. And this was the last step. Thanks for watching and have a nice day!